How do we... How do we do that? And the other question is, I'm asking specifically for the regeneration department in my ward, the degeneration department, because we've not seen since the last 30 years any council-driven regeneration initiative in Chibrook. It's all been private sector. How do we see, will we see a regeneration project in Chibrook, or is it going to be bypassed when you're talking about the leapfrog from Radford against it?
Well, I can have a go at answering that question, Councillor Radford. I think the easy way to kind of have a go at this is that this is something that we're more than happy to sit down and discuss with the council. I think the council wants to progress, for example, compulsory purchase on certain sites, then you know we can work with the council as the potential development partner to take that particular site forward. But as a company, we don't have the ability or the legal power to actually progress the CPO in our own right. What I would say as well is that, you know, even though I did say there's not a lot of council land, you know, that is a bit of a flippant remark, to be perfectly honest. There are council sites in the city, and we are looking at council sites with colleagues from the council, you know, council officers in the regional government. And what you'd like to think that you'd want to do first is kind of pick off what I would describe as the low-hanging fruit, the things that, you know, you can deliver and get on and deliver good quality housing in a good, decent timeline to get people living in those properties. Projects such as the ones you just mentioned, projects, and the Clifton one's a great example, I recall that from my days within the Regen department, they do take a long time to bring forward. So I think, you know, having a little go there, trying to answer your question the best way I can, it's not really in our gift to progress schemes in that particular way, but if the council wish to do something on a certain scheme that's problematic, we'd be happy to have a conversation with them about how we could potentially take that forward, that site forward for delivery, albeit the time scale and therefore the costs might be a challenge associated with viability. Okay?
Yeah,
no
problem.
Any questions?
Just two things. One is about the new modular buildings. Obviously, there's not been any long-standing evidence of the long-standing impact of it in the future to the new look. So how are you safeguarding yourself from any attacks in the future that will rise up? The second one, and also about the your financial exposure to that kind of model where you have to put in quite a lot of front in terms of order than you would do in the traditional build.
Okay, thank you. It is not an unknown entity because there are quite a few modular schemes around the country in modern days, but there have been a lot of modular schemes built in the UK for many, many, many years. It's not just a recent phenomenon. But I think it's fair to say that as part of our fact-finding mission, we are looking at the sustainability from a financial view. Projects and those will come through for our board's deliberation in due course. Sorry, your second question was?
Your finances.
The finances associated with that. Well, I think with every scheme, you've got to start off at the very beginning and kind of tell what's it going to cost you to get from a piece of land with nothing on it all the way through to a project that's actually finished that people can move into. And you're probably exposed to the same financial exposure in a regular with a modular build, because you may need to acquire the site, for example, if it's the wall, which would be the same. You've obviously got to secure a planning permission, which would probably be the same. Your lead in time in terms of a modular build, but you've got to probably find a way of making sure that you've got supplies for bricks and wood and other things. So there are a lot of things that are very, very similar. Now, whilst we've not concluded our work on this yet, and the conclusion to it might provide a more kind of detailed answer to your question, I'd be very surprised if there was a big difference between the two things. I think the other thing that's important to flag up as part of my answer to the first part of your question is that a modular build has now become a mortgageable project. So it's been looked at by mortgage companies across the country, the regulator, etc. was that covenant question that I think I heard sat in the row at the back. Yeah, I think, well, I'll have a go if I can recall the question properly. But I think basically from our perspective, you know, we'll be looking to rent properties and we'll be looking to sell properties. Yeah. We'll be looking to sell properties. We will put covenants on those properties so that they will not end up in a situation where we'll be HMOs. And we can do that because we are the builder, we are the developer. I mean, I'll be building them myself, somebody will be building for me. Yeah? But we will put that conditionality into the sale.
Can I thank
Luke?
Do you want to say something?
Just a small point, just to pick up on Councillor Radford's point. I mentioned on screen, I mentioned Kensington, I mentioned other areas. But I'd like all councillors to think about whether there are possibilities within their own wards. And you know, there are many pocket sites around the city that we'd like to address. It doesn't have to be a great big site of 100 houses like the yew tree sites. It could be 10, 15, 6, whatever. So I would urge councillors to look at their own wards and approach us they think there are possibilities that we might be able to develop.
Can I thank
Luke
for the presentation?
Unfortunately,
no. Can I ask a question? Unfortunately, no. Members of the public
are not able to
answer. You're not very democratic, are you?
Can I finish what I'm saying, please? You can submit a question to any select committee, but there is time scales of when questions need to be provided into the select committee. So if you have the question, we will publish the times that we will accept questions at the committee. Unfortunately, for this meeting, that has already passed, so we have not accepted any public. That item agenda is now closed. I am going to move to note the report because we have another item agenda to get through and we have time restraints at the moment. So can I move that we note the report and thank both Frank and Juan for their presentation? Is that agreed? Thank you. Item number 10, in our usual fashion, I am asking members to participate in a breakout. For members who, you know, our work programme is quite themed around each area of housing. This meeting was themed around the quality of design in new build housing, which is why we have the presentation from an architect's point of view, from a developer. So what I'm asking members to do now is to initially set three groups, but because we've had a few apologies this evening, we're going to split into two. If we can just take approximately around 10 minutes just to get into our groups, have the discussion. We will have an officer with each group. What we're looking to consider is examples of what sort of housing mix do we want in our city. Social, affordable, to what type of tenure, what standards do we aspire to? So for example, around the accessibility, but in terms of when we've just come out, I had a council meeting where we were talking around the climate change, you know, environmental impacts, what is our appetite for non-traditional or off-site builds? So Foundation's presentation, we had more information around the modular build and how do we manage estates once built, and finally how do we make our aspirations weigh in terms of cost. They're just things to consider, but anything, it's a discussion around quality of design in new build housing. So groups that I'm asking members is, can Ross, Steve and Abdul please go into the group? Kris, Joann and Lindsay.